Hello everyone and welcome back to another video diary. I'm Henry Higgins and it has been a while since we've done one of these. Now on Friday I tweeted out this comment after I had got home from work that day, and this is the video where I do reveal why I was so fucking happy and why I remain so fucking happy at the time of recording. But that reveal comes later. Transition! So, what have I been up to since the last vlog? Well, on the channel, we've reacted to the Ghostbusters Afterlife trailer, where I genuinely got teary-eyed. The Spider-Man No Way Home trailer, where I lost my shit. And the Matrix Resurrections trailer, where there was a lot of woeing going on with what was being shown on the screen. We've also been back to the cinema, having seen both Black Widow and Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings on the big screen. Both of the movies were enjoyable, and there is a review of Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings on this very channel, so go and check that out if you haven't already. We also did some wrestling predictions that didn't do that well when it came to views on the channel, though the actual predictions themselves had an 80% success rate for both SummerSlam and NXT TakeOver 36. So that is a small morsel of solace for yours truly, as it's possibly the best I've ever done on a predictions video. On top of that, we also did an unboxing for the Flash and Reverse Flash figures from Hiya Toys and started a review series for Kate Nix's The Lullaby Lounge, with two episodes live on the channel right now, so go and check them out when you're done with this video if you haven't already checked them out previously. Transition! In my personal life, it's been a slightly struggling time at work, as the effects of multiple lockdowns, COVID in general, and Brexit are all now coming to the fore. They've kind of been bubbling, but now they're all coming to a head. As the people that we're contacting, the people we're working with, are coming out of slumps themselves. It's been a knock-on process. However, everyone at work, we are just getting our heads down to get through it, and in general, the job remains one I thoroughly enjoy. It's a good group of people that are around me, and there are prospects for career advancement, still plentiful within the company, so that's good. And being kind of headhunted on LinkedIn was also quite the boost to the career-orientated self-esteem. The work ego got a hell of a boost as someone messaged me just to inquire on whether I would be interested in applying for a position at their firm. It was in London. It's a bit of a trek away. For those who aren't aware, it's like from where I am just now. Driving-wise, it would take you about three and a half hours to get there. And that would just be too far to move as it relates to my relationship with Josh. The reason I'm still in Gwynedd in Wales after me and his mum split up is to stay close to him. With that, that was obviously my work life. With my home life, that also continues to improve. There are still moments where I've allowed negative thoughts to take hold. I've been seeing a therapist for a good few months now, and it is good to talk to someone about what is troubling your mind. If you're in a similar situation, I do strongly recommend seeking out therapy yourself. If you feel the need to talk to someone, especially someone disassociated from the situation causing you your stress, your anxiety, your worries, your depression, whatever it may be, there does still remain a stigma over therapy, but from experience, first-hand experience, it really can and does help. The stigma is unjustified. Talking through your problems and working towards solutions, especially with someone, again, disassociated from the situation, they have a unique perspective that you don't in relation to that. But if you are having issues, just speak to someone. Switching gears, we are coming up to Halloween. As I record this, it's the 26th of September, which means it's time for me once again to dust off the 31 Days of Halloween movie marathon, where we watch one horror movie per day over the whole of October. Here is the list from last year, if you need reminding or if you want some inspiration for your own. Though this year's rundown is going to have a few new entries, as The Stylist, which was also reviewed on the channel, makes the cut. Alongside a movie I saw only last week, which blew my mind. Movie called Malignant. Now, I went into this movie completely blind. I'd never heard of it, hadn't seen a trailer, hadn't seen any stills, hadn't seen anything. The only aspect of the film I knew going in was that it is a horror movie and James Wan directed it, and which is enough to get me excited. James Wan has been involved with some of the better Saw movies. He's been involved with the better Fast and Furious movies. He directed Aquaman, which was phenomenal. So this had me, I must watch this. Having watched it, I can see why Malignant has been divisive, as it is a bit hokey, with plot holes a mile wide at times, but, and here's the kicker, the movie is aware of what it is. It's aware of the cheese, it's aware of everything going on, how crazy and insane it is, and it just fucking goes for it. And that is what is the major strength in this movie. There are two scenes specifically that are astoundingly shot. One is an overhead scene running through a house. The other is the semi-climactic action shot, action scene in the movie. And working through it, I thought I knew what the twist would be. And let's just say that while I was in the right direction, I wasn't even close to the insanity that actually unfolded before my eyes. If you can, go into Malignant as blind as possible. Try not to watch any trailers, try not to read anything about it, if you can. That's for the best experience. And as divisive as the movie may be, in this dojo, James Wan has created a 5-star experience. It is amazingly shot, has some wonderful ideas, doesn't skimp on the gore for when it's required, has an ingenious hook. The murder weapon, the killer's signature weapon, is a touch of genius as well. So go and see that, and look out on Twitter in the next couple of days for the full 31 Days of Halloween 2021 list that will be coming from yours truly with recommendations. And that will be the list of movies that I will be watching from October the 1st to October 31st. The list will be up on Twitter and other social medias on the 1st of October, and we'll go from there. Transition! So, to the big question. The big question teased on Friday, the big question posed at the beginning of this video, and the big question is going to be answered now. Why was I so fucking happy on Friday? So Josh was already here, and his mum Becky, my ex-wife, had cleared out her attic. And no, that isn't a euphemism. She cleared out the attic in the house, and in doing so, she found some of my things, including, as you'll see here, an NVQ qualification from March 2009, the certificate from when a star was named after my daughter, Cara Jane, an old employee of the month certificate, a best dad certificate from when Josh was a young'un, preschool Josh, and this belter of a picture from when I dressed up as the Terminator 1's T-800, for Halloween back in 2004, because I'm old. But while that did bring a smile to my face, they aren't what had me metaphorically thumping the roof of my car in glee. No, what cracked this dour Scottish facade was these. Now, what's in here? You might say, well, this is what's in here. These are X-Men trading cards. And they are trading cards that were released while the X-Men animated series, which was fucking phenomenal, by the way, was at its peak in 1994. It's not a full set, unfortunately. There are 69 and 5 duplicates, but having them back after I thought they had been lost forever just lit up my heart. Just look at them. I have no idea if they're worth anything, but to me, they are priceless. To have them back in the collection, you could even argue that they started the collection. You know, 1994, that's 27 years ago. And having them back has made my day, my week, my month, and even my year. So with such a phenomenal highlight of the weekend, what do we have to look forward to in the immediate future? Well, movie-wise, we have, in the month of October, Venom Let There Be Carnage, Halloween Kills, Dune, and Last Night in Soho. In November, we have Eternals, Ghostbusters Afterlife, and Resident Evil Welcome to Raccoon City. Then in December, we have West Side Story, Steven Spielberg's version, The Matrix Resurrections, and Spider-Man No Way Home. That rounds out 2021, and in the first quarter of 2022, we also have some goodness to look forward to as well. We'll have Morbius, and can hopefully finally find out if Michael Keaton is playing the MCU's Vulture. The Black Phone, which is getting a lot of festival buzz as I'm recording this, directed by Scott Derrickson and co-written by him, and C. Robert Cargill, who is a delightful guy you should really be following on Twitter. Great tweets, great insight, just an all-round great guy. We have the Uncharted movie, we have The Batman with Robert Pattinson, which looks brutal in the best way possible. And closing out March, the first quarter of 2022, is Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, directed by Sam Raimi, who is a phenomenal director, did the original Sony Spider-Man movies, and this is going to be epic. I believe it's being set up via the What If. It's definitely been set up by WandaVision and Loki, and Spider-Man No Way Home is the last piece of that puzzle, you have to believe. Not sure if Eternals will come into it, but from all accounts, the Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness is the most out there, insane, adventurous, ambitious movie the MCU has ever done. Oh, and on TV, we have, if you can believe it, The Sandman. Adapted from Neil Gaiman's Magnus Opus of the same name. The first teaser dropped, and it was as close to a page-to-screen translation adaptation as we could hope for. Some little niggles, but again, it's a teaser. Need to see the whole thing before we throw any shade at it. Excitement is high for this one, and I am hoping the show knocks it out the park. Video game wise, I've been kicking around with some things, tried some games that weren't really working for me, but I have downloaded Stealth Inc again. I'm working through that. Me and Josh are working through it. But hopes of getting a PS5, I feel like an 18th century explorer looking for Eldorado. I know it's out there, but where? But PlayStation Plus continues to let me build up a library of games for the PlayStation 5, which is pretty damn cool. So when it eventually does come into my possession, and I do have a PlayStation 5, there will be a library of games there for me to get my teeth into while I wait on other games coming out. Sony, and I'm a PlayStation guy, Sony had an amazing showcase a couple of weeks ago, which included teases of footage from upcoming surefire hits, such as Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic getting a remake, Project Eve, Guardians of the Galaxy, Alan Wake getting a remaster. It was an Xbox exclusive game before, so I'm quite excited to get a go of that. Deathloop, which has been getting rave reviews, it looks phenomenal. God of War Ragnarok, which again is now the official title. It was an unofficial title for long enough. It looks like it's more of the same but juiced up, which is fantastic. The first game was amazing. Spider-Man 2 was teased with Kraven the Hunter doing the voiceover, and then the bait and switch with Venom. And fucking Wolverine, again from Insomniac Games. It's like, they gave us Wolverine. Nobody expected Wolverine. We expected something from Spider-Man 2 from Insomniac Games, but having the Marvel and the Insomniac Games logo come up and then throwing a curveball by giving us Wolverine was fantastic. That is quite a lineup. I don't believe all of them will be out next year. I think some of them will be 2023. Spider-Man 2 most likely, and Wolverine for sure. But that is a hell of a list, and I'm really looking forward to working my way through all of them. Josh and I, now that lockdown and social distancing requirements have eased due to the level of vaccinations around the UK, we have the return of Wales Comic Con on November 20th and 21st. Josh, Becky and I will be going on the second day, which is the Sunday, as it is usually less crowded, so it's easier to meet the guests, etc. And what a lineup the show has this year. Now, I created a graphic a few months ago with the guest I hope to say hello to, which you can see on the screen now. So as you can see, there's Bret Hart, Kenny Omega, Jungle Boy, Britt Baker, Melina from the wrestling. Kari Tagawa, from most people will know him as Shang Tsung from the original Mortal Kombat movies and the second season of Mortal Kombat Legacy, plus he's also voiced him in the games. More recently, he was also in a great movie I loved with Sean Connery and Wesley Snipes called Rising Sun. We have Summer Glau from Firefly and Terminator, the Sarah Connor Chronicles, a show that was cancelled way too soon. Arthur Darvill from Doctor Who and Legends of Tomorrow. Matt Ryan from Constantine. Manu Bennett, I know him as mostly as Slade Wilson from the Arrowverse. Rick Cosnett from The Flash, Michael Shanks from Stargate, Mitch Pileggi from The X-Files, Sean Pertwee, Robin Lord-Taylor, Erin Richards and Crystal Reed from Gotham, Thomas Jane from The Punisher and also The Crow City of Angels, James O'Barr, who wrote The Crow graphic novel, one of my favourite graphic novels and one of my favourite movies, Mike Coulter, who played Luke Cage in the Netflix MCU series, Barbara Dunkelman from Rooster Teeth and Ruby, Troy Baker, who voices pretty much everyone, Dolph Lundgren, who I'm really excited to meet, starred in so many movies I loved in the late 80s, early 90s, James Marsters, Julia Landau and Julie Benz, all from Buffy. However, since that list was made, there have been more guests announced. So in addition to those I've just mentioned, we can also add Evangeline Lilly, Brian Cox, Dennis O'Hare, Emmett J. Scanlon, and Patricia Quinn. It's a lot of people to try and meet in one day, but we will be there for a good number of hours, 5-10 minutes tops, when meeting with the people. So it's feasible, it's possible. Bret Hart is the one from the wrestling I'm really, really excited to meet. The other ones will be fantastic as well. But if I had to pick just one, it would be Bret Hart. So there will be video and pictures from that event, so look out for that on a future video. But for now, that's who at Wales Comic Con, Josh, Becky and I are excited to see. Before we go, I've also been creating some more digital art, which you can see on the screen now. I had some negativity thrown my way, specifically being told that as I'm not actually drawing, painting or sculpting, this cannot be called art. And I took it to heart, but then after talking with some friends, decided that was an incorrect viewpoint, so I decided to throw that shit in the bin, where it belongs, and accept that what I'm doing is art. Art is subjective, art is varied, but what I'm doing is a form of art. So here's what I'm throwing myself out there. If you would like me to put something together for you, either in the vein of what you see here, what you've seen on my social media feeds, or a more bespoke idea, let me know and I will see what I can do for you. But that does it for this video. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to spend it here with me. Check out the other videos on the channel, like, share this one, and hit the subscribe button, as it all helps the channel grow. Stay safe, wear a mask, get the vaccine if you haven't already, and I will see you on the flip side, my friends. Goodbye.